beginning. Let's get back down to the simplicity of it and do what do it the way it was designed to be done. You know, who cares about gold records and golden statues and all that kind of stuff? This stuff's going to burn anyway. You know, let's lay up treasure in heaven. Let's do this thing the way it's supposed to be done. Let's give glory to God and to Him, you know, only. And He'll take care of everything that concerns us, you know, as people of God.
Absolutely. And Time Life made this. Well, Time Life, the company who does the music stuff once in a while, they had the Time Life collection, made this phrase a catchphrase, but the people out there who are doing it for themselves and are only lasting a short time, I call them one-hit wonders.
One-hit wonders, yes. Yes.
I call them one-hit wonders.
Yeah. Right. God was never a one-hit wonder.
Oh, no.
He never intended for that to happen. We should be able to bless God time and time and time and time and invite others to join in time and time and time and time again. The music that the Holy Spirit brings is timeless. You know, you meet those songs just like some of Andre's songs, you know, and they'll last forever. They will, you know, like when he did The Blood Will Never Lose Its Power.
Oh, I know.
You can't top that kind of stuff.
No, and every artist in the name has been doing that song as well. There's so many covers of that song. It's like
exactly. It's like
how many churches do you know that play "He Touched Me" from Bill Gaither? It's one of the classics. Yeah. It's something that is a timeless thing that will never ever get old.
Right, exactly, and that's what God does. He'll take a song, He'll anoint it. And it'll bless throughout generations. It'll bless throughout generations. But that's when you know that God is in it.
Absolutely.
God is in it, you know. It'll transcend generations where so-and-so may have started it off. You know, I'll say like a gate that starts, will start it off. You know, He Touched Me. How many other people down through the years, you know, have sang the same song with the same conviction? And the Holy Spirit moves.
Oh, I know. Yeah. And sometimes it's the same song, same words and everything, but it's new to you because it's done in a different style as well. But because God's never boring either. When it comes to the music, God might think, okay, this is the way it originally sounded, but I want it with this sound now over here at this person. And that can totally change the attitude of the spirit in the song, and then it can bring even newer meaning to you now than it used to back in its day. So that's why music is so very versatile, and that's which is the way God is. God's versatile. He never keeps His mind in one spot. There are times when God will say, you know, I wanted that, but I'm going to change my mind because this is what's going to bless you at this moment right over here.
Right, exactly. You know, we can lock into a box and say, we're supposed to be this way or that way or this way or that way. It's supposed to be God's way. And God's way is as the Bible says, His thoughts are not like our thoughts. You know, if you want it this way, you might want it country today. You may want it contemporary tomorrow. But that's God's prerogative to do that.
You know? Absolutely. That's why I say on Worship Saturdays, if He speaks, we have to. I mean, because during my show, I let the Holy Spirit lead, and whatever He wants is what He wants. And like I say, brother, we get into full messages right on a Worship Saturdays deal. It used to be Tuesdays. We used to get into a full message, and I'm like, we got to get back onto track. We got to get into some more worship music. We were here for Worship Saturdays, but God spoke and did what He needed to do. And there were times when I would say something, and like a friend of mine once, I was talking, and he was reading in the Word, and he was talking about with God about something, and then as soon as God spoke to me and I started speaking on a topic, he comes message me on Facebook, you know, brother, that just confirmed what God was speaking to me too. He says, thank you for saying that. You'll never know who needs what at any given moment. A buddy of mine once gave an example real quick. And he says, well, he went to his pastor one day, he says, Pastor, God told me to do backflips on stage. And the pastor thought he was a nutcase. He goes, really? God told you to do that? He goes, yeah. He goes, you sit back down. You you listen again. If God speaks to you and tells you to do it, then we'll do it. About 10 minutes later, same thing. God told you to do backflips on stage. Pastor stopped the whole service, and my buddy Tom did backflips. Tom Ray did backflips on stage, back and forth, and didn't know what he was doing. He thought he was acting like a fool, but one guy started crying his eyes out. Pastor goes, "Are you okay up there?" He goes, "I told God if someone didn't do backflips on stage today, I'd kill myself." So you never know in any circumstance what somebody is going to be going through when God speaks to you either.
Right, exactly. Exactly. You know, when the Spirit begins to move, you know, to like that, you know, God is sovereign, and he's touching. He knew, like you said, he knows who needs what, and somebody needs that song. It's one thing that, and you talk about how that, you know, you full messages have come, you know, during the worship and stuff. One thing that I understand that music, if it's done right, if it's done in spirit, can bring the prophetic anointing, which is where we get preaching or teaching from. Notice that when a prophet went about prophesying in the old days, they always had a minstrel with them, chiming on the little cymbals.
Right.
And everything. Why? Because that music was important to the anointing. People don't seek the anointing now when they're doing their praise and worship. They just want to sing a few songs. Let's sing this one. Let's sing that one. They throw something together and that sort of thing, and never have a move of God because they never tapped into that level of the anointing. You know, they're just singing a bunch of songs and stuff. I've taught some seminars on praise and worship on stuff, and one thing that I try to get the people to understand is that God will move through what you do when you let God move through what you do. But you have to labor with it long enough for him to do it. And I often refer back to that when Solomon and the musicians were praising in the temple, how the glory of God came and filled the house, that the ministers could not even stand to minister. Now, wouldn't that be wonderful if something like that ever happened in church on Sunday morning?
Oh, definitely. That'd be wonderful.
Yeah. Yeah, that would be awesome, man. I want to be in that service.
But the question is, will that happen? I mean, it can.
Will that happen?
It can, but will it happen is the question.
Yeah, well, will it happen, right? Right, and that's one thing that we capitalize on is getting the glory of God back to the church, the glory of God, because it is missing. We got a lot of intellect, you know, we got a lot of learning, book knowledge, and all of this, but where's the glory of God? The glory of God speaks of the workmanship of his hand working in our presence, you know, and him showing up. The workmanship of the hand of God touching, healing, saving, delivering in our very presence. That's the
absolutely.
Yes, yes. That's what I long to see.
And as my buddy Steve once said it this way, he says, we as a body of believers need to start the fivefold ministry, number one, and we need to be the, what's that church called at the end of times? The fivefold church, isn't it what's called, brother, I think? The church without spot or blemish is what I'm talking about.
Without a wrinkle, yeah. Mm-hmm, yeah.
We need to start that. We need to be that church that is always in the presence of God, because I find the best time that God speaks to me for anything, whether it's a message, whether it's a word of prophecy, any time that God speaks to me the best is when I'm worshiping.
Exactly, exactly, exactly. You can activate the presence of God with a simple mindset. The mindset is that I'm doing this not for myself, not for the sake of my talent, but I'm doing this to tap into the very essence of God. I'll give an example of something, and I need to sing you this song. A song I wrote a few years ago called "I Come to Worship You, Jesus." And I was in my prayer time, which I have every night, in my personal prayer time, and I got on the floor, and I started worshiping God, and I started praising the Lord, and I started blessing his name and giving him glory and honor, extolling his name. And all of a sudden, it was like out of heaven, I could hear musicians playing violins and orchestras playing the different instruments and everything. And all of a sudden, the words to the song came to my spirit. The song came to me in its totality that brought the presence of God so heavy and so plain. You can just feel it. I could feel it rolling off my body. He said, I come to worship you, Jesus. I come to worship you, my King, you know, because you are my everything. And it has such a sweet melody. What happened was that I had gotten in touch with heaven through my worship. And see, that's what music should do for us. It should cause us to get in touch with heaven through our worship. And when we can do that, then we'll begin to see the glory of God.
Absolutely.
Amen. Amen. So, you know, today, that's my sentiment about, you know, music and worship and, you know, the things that we do here at our ministry. We capitalize and we, well, I say capitalize, we focus, you know, on that aspect of this kind of life, seeing the glory of God. I told a pastor one day, I was doing a meeting in Dallas, Texas, I told a pastor one day that, you know, I'm tired of doing me. I'm done with doing me. I want to do God. I'll be me, and I'll give him what I got, but it's not for me. It's for him.
Absolutely. It's not all about me, I, me. It's all about him.
It's about him.
And once you focus, like the Bible says, on the heavenly realm, it says, seek ye first the kingdom and his exactly. righteousness. Everything else down here you do will be added unto you.
That's right. You got to, but that has to be first and not last, not something, an afterthought. That's got to be the forethought. Seek first the kingdom, you know, and his righteousness. You know, I got in the pulpit about a month ago, and I told the people, I said, I'm finished trying to impress you with my musical ability. I'm done with it. We're going to, you know, I'm going to bless the Lord with what I have. You know, my mind often goes back to what the Bible says, despise not the day of your smallness or small beginnings or that little that you have. And I think about the time when the little boy with a few loaves and fishes gave what he had to Jesus, and Jesus blessed it, and it fed the multitude. If we just take what we have, put it in the hands of the Master, and he'll bless it and bless the multitude, it'll feed, you know, it'll feed who it needs to feed. It'll touch who it needs to touch. It'll bless who it needs to bless. Just take it and put it into his hand, you know. And that's what I like to do. I like to take, you know, what I have, and put it into his hands. You know, it may not be the greatest song that's ever been written, but hey, it's what I have, and I'm putting it into his hands, and he does what he wants with it.
You know, absolutely.
That's when the glory of God can come into a place, my friend, and my God, you'll see some stuff go on. As they say, God will show up and show out.
It's like Peter, I think it was Peter and Paul in the Bible once, that he says, what I have, he says, I don't have silver and gold. He said, but what I have, I give unto thee.
I give unto you.
What, he says, take up your bed and walk. Whatever, what I have, right. though, he said, I give it to you. So he gave that spirit of God to that crippled man. That man got up and walked. He says, but what I have, I give to you.
He shared the glory of God.
He shared everything that he had. He may not have had what he wanted, just like in the music. You may not have what the audience wants, but you have what God wants.
Right, exactly. And so, you know, we tap in, you know, we stay with the anointing, we stay with the Spirit of God in all that we do, so that God can be pleased with what we do. Not impressed, because it's hard for us to impress God, can you imagine?
Oh, I know.
It's hard for us to impress God, but to please him, that can happen.
It's like Gloria once sang about one of her songs that she wrote, which was, when all of God's singers get home, she goes, We all have our little piece to that one great song that when we finally get there, that we're all going to sing our piece to.